So what do we find here? If we look at the histogram of the spikes per neuron, we find that there's some neurons that fire very rarely. In fact, there's a good number of neurons that only fire here like a couple thousand times during the 45 minutes of recording that we have here. And then there's some neurons that fire 20,000 times. And hey, there's even some neurons here that fire well more than 120,000 times. And this is something people that aren't used to neuroscience, they're often, when they first see it, they're a little bit shocked that there's a relatively small number of neurons that produce really, really high firing rates. So much so that like a relatively small number of neurons might contribute considerably to the overall spike count. And then we have this distribution. It is a heavy tail distribution, which is very, very typical for any kinds of brain data. So if we zoom into the traces, we see spikes. So here you see a typical spike raster plot. Every time where there's a line, it means that a spike happened. Not like here we have like at 5.5 seconds, there's a spike, and a little later, there's another spike, and so on and so forth. Now, given that we have these spike trains, what are good questions that we might want to ask? Well, there's a million things that we might want to ask. No, we might want to ask, how do the spikes relate to the outside world? How do the spikes relate to what the animal wants to do? How does it relate to behavior? There's just so many different ways how we could analyze the spikes. Today, we will look at a very simple idea here, which is interspike intervals. What are interspike intervals? It's the time from one spike here to the next spike here. Look, these first two have a very short interval, and then there's a little longer interval, which you see here, and so on and so forth. Each of these lines up there is the duration between one spike and the next spike. And ultimately, there's the idea that by looking at interspike intervals, we can learn something about the biophysics of neurons. Therefore, broadly, we find it interesting. Even if we can't build a meaningful model of how the neurons actually do it, it's certainly something that we'd want to look at and understand. Now, let me wear my first hat. I'm now wearing my what hat. So, how will a scientist following what ideas approach this? Well, there must be some kind of a distribution of interspike intervals. Maybe it's even similar across neurons. I find that interesting because it must somehow reflect physiology. How could it look like? Well, I don't know. However it looks like, it will somehow help me think about brains. And because I like equations, I would like an equation that describes what's going on there. So how could it look like? Well, it could be that all interspike intervals are equally likely up to some upper bound. Or it could be that all interspike intervals are very similar in size. How will it look like? Well, we don't know at this time. The only way to find out is to look at the data. And the Steinmetz data is quite typical, as we will see. Now, let's calculate the interspike intervals and the histograms. What do you need to do? Well, you will need to calculate what the interspike intervals are. And of course, we will again want to look at the histograms, in this case, for an individual neuron.